My name is Andrea Spindle, and it's a real pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the Jewish Diversity Committee and the Israel Connection Committee of Congregation Darchei Noam. Here are a few notable items about Naim, who was born in Baghdad in 1928. He studied law at the University of Baghdad from 1945 to 47, and literature at the Sorbonne from 47 until 51. He immigrated to Montreal in 1954, and in 1984, he became head of the Writing and Publishing Division of the Canada Council. He is the author of over 40 books, translated into several languages. He himself writes in English, French, and Arabic, and has been honored for publications in all three languages. What amazed me in reading his celebrated work, Farewell Babylon, is that there are numerous dialects in Iraq, depending on your tribe or ethnicity, your status, as well as location, and Naim seems to have mastered several of these. So it gives me great pleasure and delight to invite our guest speaker, Naim Kattan, to address you.
Thank you very much, Andrea, for this presentation. I'm very happy to be in Toronto. I used to come very often when I was working for the Canada Council, but it has been many years that I haven't been back here, but I'm very happy to be again here and to be at this synagogue and to be able to speak to you about the Jews of Iraq. So I'll start speaking about my childhood and boyhood, because I left Iraq when I was 18 years old. The major part of my life I spent in Canada, but still Iraq is very present in my life and in my thinking. When the Shabbat used to be announced to come, you used to take a shower before that and dress correctly. And my mother used to prepare for the Shabbat, and my father used to do the ceremony, and the second and following day we used to go to the synagogue. This is my childhood and my boyhood. But this is also the same, it would be the same for almost all the Jews of Baghdad. The Jewish community of Baghdad constituted the third of the population of the city. Baghdad was a Jewish city. The Jews were not only in business or in having stores and commerce, but they were also writers, lawyers, professors, doctors. And when I remember one day on Yom Kippur, before going to the synagogue, I went to the center of the city. Almost everything was closed. And on Shabbat, the Muslims didn't go to the market themselves, to the souk, because the Jews were not going to be there. People didn't used to go to shop on Shabbat, the Muslims also. So we felt as part of the city. We were part of the city, and we were everywhere in the city. The Jews of Iraq were not only Arab-speaking, they had their own dialect in Arabic. Everybody had a different dialect in Arabic. The Jews, the Christians, the Armenians, the Muslims, the north, the south, they are different dialects, but everybody understood everybody else. And the written language is everywhere the same. So when when we went to school, we were in Jewish school, but we could go to the other schools too. And the majority of the population of Iraq was illiterate. And part of the Jews also were illiterate, although for every male, Jewish male, wanted his son to be able to say the Kaddish. So there were Jewish schools that were open so that most of the Jews could say the prayers, at least. So the Jews were less illiterate than others, but there were also a lot of them were illiterate. It was the country as it was. But the first minister of finance of the Iraqi government in 22 was Sasson Hisqel, a Jew. He made a very important contribution. He remained the minister for 20 years, and he made a great contribution to Iraq. He was, when he negotiated the price that the British would pay for the petroleum. Petroleum was discovered in 1917. So the British would say, I think it was five sterling pounds for a ton or something like that. He said, don't say only sterling pound. We don't understand that, all of, we in Iraq. Say it in gold. Say 1 pound in gold. So they say, okay, he's ignorant, it's all right. They are ignorant, these people, we'll say gold. But he was very, very astute, because he knew that gold will be twice worth twice more than in 10 years than the sterling pound. So now Iraqis say, we had a financial minister, a Jew, who was more intelligent than all the British. And they didn't know that. So, and they celebrate, and they say, and I give that example, there are many others, because the Iraqis were not only a minister or a member of parliament and so on, but they were also the head of the railways, the head of the post office. They were in government, and they were also in the teaching, teachers and professors all over. Some of the a lot of the Jews from the 19th century till the they left, they went all over the world to establish Jewish Iraqi communities. It is part, and I always ask myself why they did that. And I tried to find out what it means, why the Jews were in Shanghai, why they were in Mandalay, why they were in Calcutta, why they were in Tehran, and they had communities, they established Iraqi communities all over, and many other places, in Manchester. And I asked myself why. I think because the Iraqis, as a desert people, were nomads. And the Jews were nomadic in their own way by going around the world, not in the desert, but around the world. And this is the way I tried to find it out. I wrote a novel called Le Fortune du Passager, which was not translated yet in English, in which I describe a person who goes around the world and meet all these Jewish communities around the world of Iraqi Jews. And I will tell one or two stories afterwards. But I want to come back to the way that the Jews spent their lives in Baghdad. They were, all the communities were isolated from each other. There was no intermarriage. The Muslims didn't know who was Shiite and Muslims, and now they kill each other because they are Shiite or Sunnis. Sunnis and Shiites still kill each other, but at that time it was all the same and there was no problem. But there were no intermarriages, there were no visits to each other, because this is the way of life in a very ancient way. And the Muslims wouldn't have anybody inside the house where the women are. They would, and so on. And but still, the relationships were available, and people worked together in the government, in businesses, in stores, and they were all together. But they were the relationship were not very intimate, but they were all right. they worked in Arabic, and we were very proud to know Arabic even more than the Iraqis themselves. The best school in Arabic was the one to which I went, the Alliance Israélite Universelle, to which I will come back later. So the Jewish community felt itself autonomous, independent. How did it survive financially as a community? They found a way which was very, very interesting, is to sell the kosher meat at a special price and ask for a company to have the monopoly of producing the kosher meat. And that company would give the community so much money to have the community services and so on. And the people, and nobody would eat anything else in among the Jewish community but kosher. There was no way of thinking otherwise. So the people would pay by buying meat, they would pay for the community services. And the community services were very important because it was done through the idea of the mullahs of the Turks, the Ottoman Empire, who dominated Iraq before the World War I. And which means that the Hakam Bashi, the head, the chief rabbi, would have the entire authority on marriages, inheritance, all the family life was done by communities. The Christians, the Muslims, and the Jews had their own community services. And this was paid by the kosher meat. So I think that the Jewish community survived that way, and also it survived by having its own schools and its own institutions. How this did happen? The Jews who left Iraq and made fortunes elsewhere used always to come back to get married. This is one of the major things, and to get to find women for them, spouses. And with their money, they would establish schools, institutions, health institutions, and for example, there were two major hospitals in Baghdad. One was the hospital, the government hospital, the one that was public hospital, and the other one, which is as important, was a Jewish hospital. And the only institution for ophthalmologic medicine was Jewish, and the trachoma used to be the victims of a trachoma, the eyes disease. 80% of the population had it because of the weather. So the Jews were very important in helping by their own services all the population. And the Jewish hospital didn't have only patients who were Jewish, but it was open to others too. So it was a very, when I see it from now, I see it after so many years, I see that it was a very compact community which did all its life extremely well. So when the people came to Baghdad from outside, the Sassoons, the Kadouris, they established schools. The school and these schools were not only for boys, they were schools for girls also, and which was very uncommon in Iraq. That there were girls' schools at that time. And the Sassoons, which were very well known in Britain afterwards, even Sigrid Sassoon became a minister and so on, The school where I went, the Alliance Israelite Universelle, was built by Sassoon, Albert Sassoon. And the Kadouris built, the other Kadouris built the school for the girls. At these schools, in the school where I left, I made my studies, was established by the building was done by Albert Sassoon, but the establishment was done by the French community, which established schools all over the Middle East. And in our school, we learned four languages. Arabic, which was the major language, French, English, and Hebrew. So we, and the Shamash school, and we had the, and the Shamash school, which was the other school, had did the matriculation, the British matriculation, through the help of the Jewish community of Manchester, which built the school. So every family, every people who were abroad will come back, establish schools, health services and so on to help the community, and then go back and leave their names there so that they, people will know that they were there. I want to and some of them became so important, the Sassoons became very important in India and in Britain, and the Kadouris too. I want to tell a story of my meeting with Lord Kadouri in Hong Kong. He owned, there were two lords, Kadouri's brothers. They owned the tramways, the electricity. They would half of Hong Kong was they belonged to them. And one of the Iraqis went there, met with Lord Kadouri, and he wanted to give him a gift. He didn't want to give what gift to give somebody who owned everything. So he gave him my book. And Lord Kadouri said, if this chap comes to Hong Kong, he should come and meet me. So at one time, the Canadian government sent me a delegation of three people, I was one of them, to establish cultural relations between China and Canada. So I, and at that time, Hong Kong was not part yet of China, but I said to the Canadian embassy, I wanted to go there and stay a few days to be able to meet Lord Kadouri. So, I went and Lord Kadouri had the biggest collection of ivory, of Chinese ivory, and he made me see it. And he told me something that, and I sat with him, that this is a lord, a British lord, who had everything and so on. And I felt like I was speaking with an uncle from Baghdad in a coffee shop near the Tigris. He spoke to me in Arabic, and he was familiar with me. And he said, how are you? You are not spending the Shabbat here. We have a club. I said, no, I have to go. And he said, his father told me, his father told him that he owned nothing, that all he had was to administer only. It didn't belong to him. And he said, when the Vietnamese came to Hong Kong, he told them he didn't give them money.
I just wanted to speak more right into the
He doesn't want to give them money, but he established for them a village where they can work and make a living. He said, this is the way to help people, is to help them make a living rather than give them money. So, then when I stayed in the hotel in Shanghai, the name of the hotel was the Peace Hotel. It was built by Kadouri. And this is the hotel where Nixon and Chou En-lai met. And when I went to that hotel and stayed there, I said, It was an Iraqi Jew who built the hotel where Nixon and Chou and Lai met. It was something for me. And then Lord Kaduri asked me, did you go to the children's palace? I said, yes, it was a great institution for the Chinese. Of course I visited. It is, well, it was my house. But so it's all right, he wasn't poor in Hong Kong, and he wasn't poor elsewhere. But this is the way, among the other Jews in Asia, in Singapore, the first prime minister of Singapore was called Marshall. His real name was Mash'al. And he became the prime minister of Singapore. And the Jewish community of Singapore was quite Iraqi, was quite important at one time. That all this was part of our view of the world. And our view of the world was that we were everywhere, and we always came back to Baghdad to either to get married or to establish institutions, and we were part of it, and we thought of it. And I had two of my uncles went to Iran and established themselves in Tehran. And so in every family, there were people somewhere in the world of the Iraqi Jews. So the Jews of Iraq were doing well, spending their lives quite well, and improving themselves in schools, in education, and in money, and in business. So one day, in the 30s, when Hitler took power, he sent to Iraq an ambassador, Herr Grobe. And Herr Grobe started very intelligently for himself to infiltrate the Iraqi army. So many officers became Nazis. And Nazism started to infiltrate itself in Iraq at the end of the 30s. And in 41, during the World War II, the British used to control Iraq, but they were not present. They had two army bases, military bases, which nobody could go there, but they were there, and the British were there. So the Iraqi government, in 41 was Nazi, and declared war on Britain, and they expected Hitler to come and help them. Hitler didn't come because he was going to invade the Soviet Union. So the Rashid Ali government, the Nazi government, lost the war, and the British didn't come as fast as it might have been able to come, and there was no government, so there was what we call the Farhud. The Farhud was the pogrom. And for the first time, the Jews of Iraq felt that they were all by themselves, alone, with no protection, and no self-help either, because they felt they were integrated to the country and they were not going to be looted, killed, and so on. And for me, I was then 12, 13 years old, and I remember that we were on the roof listening to hearing the shots coming closer and closer. And I used to tell myself, I am going to die before having even started to live. It was terrible. It was a terrible trauma for the Jews of Iraq after 25 centuries to find themselves all by themselves without any help, without any protection, being looted, assassinated, and it was terrible. But afterwards, the government tried to help, but a few years later, Israel was born. And then the Iraqi government declared war on Israel. And then the life of Iraqi Jews became impossible. In 51, there was a head of the government said, we can't control all, they tried to control all the Jewish businesses, try to not let them do this or that, or being in the civil service. So they said, it's impossible to control that, let them go. So they made an arrangement with Israel, and they said the Jews can go, and you pick them up in Cyprus. They travel to Cyprus, and you pick them up and take them to Israel. So they had a law saying that the Jews could leave. They didn't say they have to go to Israel. They said they could leave. Everybody knew that they were going to go to Israel. So the majority left. The greatest majority left. And it was very hard because I went to Israel to see my family living in the Ma'bara, which was terrible. It's very terrible conditions. The terrible conditions were they lost all their properties, all their businesses, all they were nothing. They came there and all they had was the help of Israel to put them in cabins and till they could have houses and so on. And finally, now I say fortunately the Iraqi government obliged the Jews of Iraq to leave. Because if not, they would have been, by Saddam Hussein afterwards and all the other, they would have been killed, looted, everything. But they left. They had difficulties in Israel for 10, 20 years, but they are all right now. They are everywhere in Israel. I go to Israel and I find them all over, in government, in businesses, everywhere. They are even doing without doing it openly. They are doing very good businesses with the Kurds of northern Iraq, illegally in a way. But it's all right. The Kurds are almost independent now of Iraq. And I have to say that when my book Feral Babylon was translated in Italian. The launching party was in Italian library, and I went there, and I was invited to dinner by the Canadian ambassador. But at the launching party, the ambassador of Iraq was there, and he came to see me. His name is Barzani, and the Barzanis now control. The northern of Iraq. It's a big tribe, Kurdish tribe. He said, how come didn't you come to see me? I said, well, I'm sorry. He said, next time you come and live in my house when you come to Rome. And I said, okay, yes, sure. And he said, we are waiting for you in Baghdad. Why are you not coming to Baghdad? I said, with bombs. He said, I will come with you. I said, yeah, you come with me to Erbil, to Kurdistan, but not to Baghdad. He said, well, we will see that. Anyway, the Iraqis now try to say that they are sorry that the Jews left, but they left already. But they are sorry because they left, they had themselves to leave Iraq, many of them all over the world. They are all over the world. So the Jews of Iraq were a compact community, and they knew their history. I have to tell you also, when I was at school, every year we used to go to Babylon to visit Babylon as students of the Alliance School. And the teacher, I remember that, would stand in front of us and would say, you see, here our ancestors came as slaves, as prisoners. slaves of Nebuchadnezzar. And you know that they felt that they were free, and they were free, and you know how? They had a book. And that book, they studied it. And they didn't only study it, but they commented on it. They wrote the Talmud. And here our ancestors, they were slaves, and they were free because they came and studied the Bible and wrote the Talmud. And in a way, he was telling us to be good students. But for me, it was very important lesson of my teacher was very important to me, because all I have written 50 books, and I said, my ancestors wrote the Talmud. How can I be deserving of that ancestry? How can I be worth of being the inheritor of this great knowledge, this great contribution to Judaism, not only to Judaism but to humanity? Judaism is a contribution to humanity. And I said, and this makes you humble and makes you want to be able to be worth of what you have received in history. Then, recently, the Muslims of Montreal, they have a community. Some of them have some money because they went to Abu Dhabi and made money there, and some of them made money out of corruption and so on. They came to Canada and they had money, and the others were trying to survive, to just left Iraq to be able to survive. And they had an evening in honor of their, as they say, their important Iraqi writer, myself. They invited me, and they went there with my wife, who doesn't speak Arabic. So they made speeches in Arabic. The whole evening was just Arabic, not one word in other language. So they spoke, they said great speeches about the contribution of the Jews of Iraq and the importance of the writing of Naim Kattan and how he described Baghdad. I wrote another novel, Farida, also, which was translated into Arabic, about the greatest singer of Iraq, Salima Murad, who was the biggest singer, woman singer of Iraq. But it wasn't a real story about her, but the publisher, when the book was translated, put her picture on the cover. But anyway, so they were very proud of their Jewish community, which was not there anymore. They were themselves exiles, and they were away in Montreal. And they said, and one after the other, they would come and make speeches about my books, and about, especially about the Jews. How the Jews, and also they would say, my mother was the greatest friend of her neighbor who was a Jewish, and my uncle was the greatest friend of his partner who was Jewish, and they would all come and say the Jews were this and that. And then they asked me to speak, and they gave me a talk in Arabic about my own contribution as a young boy to the literary work, because I established with Muslims two periodicals, Arabic periodicals, literary periodicals. So I was saying whom I have known as writers and with whom I worked and so on. They were very interested and impressed, because all these writers were gone and were famous, and most of them died. And so afterwards, I told myself, okay, I say it is another life I had. And I talk about it, and as I'm trying to talk tonight, it's another life. It doesn't go that easily. It doesn't disappear. It's always there. But what disappears is a society. I belong to a society. I didn't always agree with that society. I felt I wanted to be free. I wanted to go abroad. And I would have gone abroad anyway. My uncles went to Iran. Others went to somewhere else. And I wanted to go also abroad. And I would have gone. But still, I would have always been able to see that there was a community somewhere which was mine and to which I would go. There is one community which is mine now in Montreal, which is at the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue, which is mostly Iraqi now. Not mostly, but the president and so on, they are Iraqis, and the Iraqis settled in that synagogue and made it theirs. So I'm part of that too. But it's still not our community of Baghdad. So what does it mean to have had the community? It means that I feel that I can't be anything else but a Jew from Baghdad. I say I am a Jew, of course, but I always say a Jew from Baghdad because it gives it a special meaning to me and a special savor. A flavor, I say it in French, but it's a special flavor for me to be from Baghdad. So, the community is lost, the community is gone, but the Jews are there. They are in Israel, they are in Canada, they are all over the world, but they are alive. And thanks God, they are alive. And I feel very, very proud to have been part of that community and to be able to speak about it and to celebrate its existence and its history, as something that meant something to the Jews all around the world. And I want to say I was very when the Yiddish writer singer came to Montreal, I spoke to him and I said, in your novel Satan in Gorai, you speak about Babylon. How come you speak about Babylon and Baghdad, you in from a Yiddish writer from Poland, Bashevi singer? And he said, you know, the Jews who were very, very orthodox in Warsaw said that they belonged to the Babylonian community. I said, okay. When I went to Rome, to the synagogue, they said their minhag is Babylonian. So they asked me, they made me the honor to go to Aliyah at that time, and I didn't find the minhag Babylonian. I didn't know what was the Babylonian minhag anyway. So I say it's interesting that we survive not only in our own country, in our own minds, but from Italy to Warsaw, from Rome to Warsaw, we are still there. Thank you.
Thank you, Naim. We're going to have a question and answer now. I'm going to give this mic to Danny, and he'll take it to anyone who has
the treasures that were taken from Baghdad, rescued, actually, by the Americans, and 27,000 artifacts have been digitized. And the Iraqi Jews around the world want to know what's going to happen to the collection, because I understand the government of Baghdad wants it back. So perhaps you could tell us what you think is possible going to happen.
I think the best thing is the Iraqi government will not give it to Israel. The best thing is that all these would go to Israel. It's where the majority of Iraqi Jews are and where the major part of Iraqi knowledge also A lot of it is in Israel. But they wouldn't give it. And as they are, as these papers are now in Washington, I think they should still remain in the United States, and to be given, and the Jewish community in the United States, the Iraqi Jews of the United States have made a request, and I signed it also myself, so that these papers, these remnants will go, will remain in the United States. This is what should happen, I think.
I enjoyed it. I have a question. Evidently, we saw in the world, history shows us that when economy or a country is in trouble financially, they call on the Jews to save them. We saw that in Britain with this Benjamin Disraeli, in France with the Rothschilds, and evidently we see it today in Spain when they call the Jews to come over. Do you see anything like that happening in the future in Iraq?
No. What you say is very pertinent in a way, because there was somebody who I received articles in the Baghdad papers, in Iraqi papers, in Arabic. They sent it to me by email, writing about my books, which are translated into Arabic. Feral Babylon is translated into Arabic, and there are many, many commentaries on it. And one of the articles, one of the writers said, we have to ask the Iraqi government has to open the doors of Iraq to the Jews to come back, and also to compensate to those who lost their properties. This is a Muslim who says that. Okay, to compensate is very important. I have to say that the Jews of Iraq, Ben Porat and other Jews who are in Israel, who were members of parliament, of the Knesset, wanted the Israeli government to say that the Jews of Iraq were refugees and they lost their money and they had to be compensated by Iraqis. But the Israeli government, and I was once I was in Paris in the conference of the about the Arab Jews, the Jews of Arab countries who were out of their Arab countries, and spoke about their having lost their properties and so on. And I said they were refugees, and the ambassador of Israel said there are no Jewish refugees in Israel. The Jews who go to Israel are not refugees. They go back to their country. So the Israeli government now is starting to say that they can be considered as refugees, but they say they are not refugees. They become, they are part of Israel. And this is a problem. But now that the Arabs want to come back to Israel, the Arab refugees, what I say, they are refugees. In a way, they say there are Arabs who, from Arab countries, choose from countries who came to Israel. So there is a talk of political exchange in that sense. I don't know what is the future of that, but I don't see that the Jews of I don't see my son or my grandsons would ever want, even if my son by chance married a Jewish girl of Iraqi origin, but I don't see that they would go back to Iraq. I don't see that. They are part of the world where they live, and but the compensation might come, might. But Iraq is in such a bad situation. It would continue for long. I don't see it being solved soon. It's terrible.
Hi. Yeah, you want? I wanted to ask about food and Shabbat. When you grew up, what kind of food did your mother prepare for Shabbat? What was the kind of foods that...
Food.
Food, you know, Shabbat food.
Yeah.
that special day? The only
meat we had was lamb, mutton, lamb. It was very greasy and I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. And my mother used to make omelets for me because of that. And we had things with sugar and so on. It was, but there was no other, beef was not known at all. And veal was not known at all, but mutton and chicken. Chicken was also very present. And my father used to be a benevolent shohet of chicken, but benevolent. So before Yom Kippur, we had a lot of people coming to our house to have their chicken stained by my father. But my father told me at that time, and I still think of it, that you have to make a prayer before every time that you kill an animal, you have to make a prayer, that God has to permit you to do that.
I know foods were different than the Ashkenazi, that's what I was...
Okay, next question here.
What were the feelings about Israel and Zionism in your generation with your peer group? What were the beginnings? Was it strong? Was it indifferent? After all, you're such an entity of 2,500 years. What was the, and you were so secure.
No, I mean, the Iraqi Jews were not really Zionists. They were part of them were Zionists. After the Farhud, after the pogrom, there were two directions. A lot of them became communists. Mm-hmm. And the Communist Party of Iraq was not permitted, was secret. And some of them were persecuted afterwards, and one of the people I knew was killed even in that. There were a lot of Jews in that, and Christians, and Shiites, and Shiites also, Shiites. But others bought arms to arm themselves, and they were the Zionists from Israel helped to have Jews become Zionists and so on, and some of them became Zionists and went to Israel, but the majority wanted to remain in Iraq, and the Hacham Bashi, the head Khduri, was always said, we are faithful Iraqis. We have nothing to do with Israel. We are faithful Iraqis after 48. He tried to make life possible for Iraqi Jews. But a lot of them went secretly to Israel before they were thrown out. They went through with the help of Kurdish people through Iran. And from Iran, they went directly to Israel. Iran was open then. There was a good relationship between Iran and Israel. So they would go to Iran, and from Iran, they go to Israel. But, and the only communist paper which was published openly in Baghdad was called itself the anti-Zionist paper. it was done by Jews. But also many Muslims wrote in it, but it was a communist paper. It said because it was fighting Zionism that it could be published openly, but it didn't last for many, it lasted only for 3 or 4 months. But they found out, the government, it wasn't really anti-Zionist, it was just communist.
Hi, I just have a quick question about literacy rates, because you talked a little bit about it, but I'm wondering if you might be able to touch a little bit upon the access to books, like Hebrew literature, even access to various Torahs. Like, what was the literacy like for mostly boys, I'm sure, but I have a Syrian friend who can recite almost the whole Torah off by heart. And I'm just wondering about the Iraqi community, what that, what it was like in terms of literacy and books and that sort of thing.
Yeah, literacy is a major, it's a major problem in the Middle East and in many other countries in Africa and in Asia. Literacy, it's still, there are still many illiterate. There are less illiterate people now, but there are still a lot. So, and I think the governments, they could spend the money they put into big buildings and into buying palaces in Europe, rather to build schools and teach their children how to read and write and to be able to improve themselves by reading literature and reading science and something else. But literacy is a very important problem in the Arab countries. And I don't know, maybe the literacy now, the illiterate people are 40% in Iraq, I don't know, or 30 or 40% maybe. I don't have the statistics. They wouldn't give it anyway.
Thank you for your talk. It was lovely. I really wanted to turn it more to a literary question and ask you if you could speak a little bit about the literary community that you have found in your life, who have been the influences who have shaped you or helped your own writing and your thinking evolve over your life, and where have you found literary community, whether it's in Montreal, whether it's an international literary community, whether it's a Jewish literary community. I'm just kind of curious.
Well, it's a very, very long story. I'm writing a book about that anyway. But I have written it already, and it's going to be out in a few months. But anyway, the first literary importance for me were Arab writers. Gibran, whose name is known in English because he wrote one book in English. But his books in Arabic were major for me when I was 10. His style in Arabic was fantastic, because he wasn't it wasn't a Quranic style. He was Christian, and he wrote a book on Jesus, even in Arabic, which is not well known. But so he was a major, and other Lebanese and many other writers in Egypt, Taha Hussein and Tawfiq Al Hakim. When my book Pharaoh Babylon came in France, Michel Tournier said that it made him think of Taha Hussein. And I said, it's a great, great honor for me to be compared to Taha Hussein, who's a great writer from Egypt. But others afterwards, there were plenty of them. The major part of them, they were French. Gide, whom I have known personally, whom I have written a lot about, Malraux, whom I've known personally, I've written a lot about, and they wrote to me letters and so on. And there were many others. But when I came to North America, the man whom, with whom I, the writer in North America with whom I felt very, very much at home was Saul Bellow. Saul Bellow was, for me, a very, very important writer. And when I asked him, I have to tell you a story about him. He was born in Lachine, near Montreal. And he described Montreal in one of his books. And my mayor of Lachine called me one day, it was long ago, and he said, we are going to have a library. We want to call it the Saul Bellow Library, because he said not every day somebody of Lachine will get the Nobel Prize. And he said, as I have written about Saul Bellow in Montreal, quite a few articles, he said, you are the one who knows him. Would you want to be one of the speakers? Saul Bellow will be there. I said, well, Saul Bellow will be there. Let us see. I said, okay, I will come. I came, and Saul Bellow was there. I sat beside his wife, the wife of that time. We had that for three or four. But and when I spoke to him afterwards to him, he came to me and he said, this is the touch of a writer. And I felt very, very close to him when he told me that, because we were, and he was wonderful. He was wonderful. In Lachin, the mayor gave a festival in outside for everybody to come and have free hot dogs. But afterwards there was inside lunch and so on. But this is one of the writers. And I feel very close also to some Yiddish writers like Singer, as I said. But there are a lot of writers too. The great writer for me is, of course, Shakespeare. But the greatest book remains all the time the Bible. The greatest.
One more question.
I waited to the end. I'm a daughter of two Iraqi parents. They came from Basra. And the story from there, I hear it's completely different. Either they had a different life there, or the experiences is a little bit, they were older a little bit than you. I heard a lot about of the Fahud, when the Arabs attacked the Jewish people, when the stores got all robbed and looted. My father himself was in the prison because he was suspected as a communist. There's a lot of story about the communists that I didn't know, and I heard it through story in China, that the communist group was promising all the Jewish young people that they're going to be equal. There's no people against them. So there's a lot of movement from the Jewish youngster. And after that, the family had to flee Basra, and I'm talking about the all extended family, because the Iraqi government was putting all kind of secret police beside the stores, who's going, who's coming. Some of the uncle had to flee through Iran, as you said. And I think this is part that we miss in this whole pictures, because in a way, when I heard you, I heard the very pink or nice story about Baghdad. But the Jewish had a lot of suffering before they came to Israel. It's not, maybe they wanted to, part of them wanted to stay, but as experience, my family experience, they had to leave, otherwise they would be hanged. Some of them had to buy themselves, or the family would buy it from the police, or secret police have to bribe in order to take the Jewish people to Israel. And I think maybe if you could elaborate more about it.
Yeah, I didn't want to go to such details because, but it's very important. One of the things I can tell you is that at one time, before 48, before the just a year ago, before Israel was born, and afterwards, a lot of people were put in prison, including my own brother. I was in Paris then, and my own brother was put in prison. He was a lawyer, but he was also in the civil service in government, in the Department of Interior Ministry. But he was put in prison, and the accusation for everybody then was Zionism communism. They put it together. The Jews of Basra were smaller. I had an uncle there, and I went there, and it was a smaller community, but it was part of the Iraqi community. They had the same kind of. I don't think the Farhud was big there, but it did happen apparently, in a smaller way. But
My mother telling me that they had, as a kid, to hide, and the neighbor, Arab neighbor, would take them or hire guard to make sure that nobody would go into this house because it's a Jewish house.
A lot of others did that too during the Farhud. The Muslims were, some of them were all right, I mean, with the neighbors. But the Jews had to leave at one time because one of my school students was one of the people who were hung, Horesh. He was at school with me. But there were a lot of individual things that happened. But we are all gone. We have all left. It's fortunate. And I see that even here, in come to Toronto to speak, and I see people of Iraqi origin, which is wonderful.
Any other questions?
Quick question. I want to say, Mr. Kattan, it's a great privilege for all of us to have heard you, and thank you very much. I was curious about one thing, and there may not be a short answer. From 1941 until the war, Second World War ended, there was a Nazi government in Iraq. And you describe when the pogrom came, the Jewish community was on its own. Had there been efforts when the Nazis came to power, had the Jewish community made efforts from 1941 or even before it to defend itself in any way against this? Had there been a sense that there must have been some sense of peril? Was there an attempt before the pogrom either to discuss immigration or to bribe the government? Did the community itself make efforts, or did it remain, did it have a false sense of security because of history?
I think before the pogrom, I don't think there was any effort really, not a major effort. Some of the people did leave, go to Israel, but very few. But what happened afterwards, there was a big movement of people having arms, arming themselves. I remember my uncle, who lived with us, came one day with a revolver. And he was trying to manipulate it and so on. He said, "Now, if they come, I will be on the roof, and I will." But and there were a lot of others who tried to do that. But most of them left afterwards and went to Israel. And in Israel, I have to say also, and this I have to add. I didn't mention it, that they became very important in Arab studies and Arab relationships, the Iraqi Jews. The heads of the Arab studies in Jerusalem, Shmuel Moreh, in Tel Aviv, Sausan Sumer, in Haifa, the universities, Shamhoun Balas, they were all friends, they are writers, and they are specialists of Iraqi, of Arab culture, and they became part of the Israeli when Naguib Mahfouz got the Nobel Prize in Egypt. He said the greatest commentator of his work is is my friend from the University of Tel Aviv, Sasson Sumer, who wrote a book about it. But so, the Jews did find ways, but they armed themselves, but it wasn't enough. They had to go to Israel or somewhere else. I think the best thing that happened to us is what to leave Iraq. And I thank God that we all left, because we would have suffered so much. But we are here, and elsewhere, but we are out.